Micah Frankel. It's Fight Week, Bellator 218, this Friday in Thackerville, Oklahoma. And I'm lucky enough to be able to welcome in one half of the main event. Emmanuel Sanchez joins us right now.
Hey, Emmanuel, how you doing today?
Good, my friend. How you doing?
Good to talk to you again. So how's this
camp? You as well, too.
Right. How's this camp been going?
Very good, my friend. Just hard work, dedication, 24/7. You know, I mean, not even 25/8. You never went 26/9. You know, all day, every day. You know what I mean? It's nonstop for me.
Gotta ask, what were the feelings coming off of the disappointment of the title fight not turning out how you expected, how you planned?
Not having that belt around my waist right now and having that the actual title behind my name, you know, world champion. So it's I'll be real, it sucks, man. It's heartbreaking. It really sucks. That's all I can say. It's just damn, you know. I'm gonna watch my language on here, but you know, when I was just in the hotel room, all I could say was the F word, you know, like repeatedly, and just, you know, that's all I thought of. But I have to just use this as motivation, man. You know, like Batman, you know, why do we fall? We're going to pick ourselves back up. So it's a hunger and a desire. I see it as God's plan to, you know, it only made me hungrier and more motivated to really go out there and their business. It made me mature, you know. So I don't think enough the people use that word or think about that enough. That they've grown in training, or what difference you can do in training, or your diet, or your life, or whatever. It's a little maturing as a fighter, and growing, you know. So I've learned a lot, grown, and now I'm excited to showcase what taught me, what I had to learn from myself too, to go out there and get the performances that I and the finishes that I really want.
You look back at that fight with Pitbull. Do you have some positives that you can take away from what you did in the cage?
Well, yeah, I wanted the rematch, and it looks like they didn't want that. So, they were in a rough idea again, because I was hoping that they would lock that up right away. And that's what my management and Bellator said that they were looking forward to do, too. But, all right, you got a bigger, better fight in his eyes, you know, against Michael Chandler. So that's fine. God bless. He's absent for a while. Right now, I see myself as the number one guy, so I need to go out there and cement my status as the number one guy and the best guy in the world outside of the champion, because the champion fears me. So I want to make sure everybody fears me. And that's, you know, the positives is here I was thinking that this was the toughest, baddest dude, and for being the toughest, baddest dude, I thought he'd be harder to hit, and I thought he'd hit harder. So, you know, he said he was going to finish me and kill me, and that's what they all say, but they have yet to show me anything. So, you know, I have to take all those responsibilities and use it as a hungry motivation, knowing that, okay, these guys want to kill me, good, all right, I'm coming to get you too, bro. Let's see what you got. I'll meet you in the middle, you know what I mean? And don't run away from me, and don't try to hold me down against the fence. Let's see what you got, you know? So I'm hungry and motivated, man. You know, I'm a man who not only hungers the title and the belt and the gold and all that, it's the victory. Now it's getting my hand raised. So the victor goes spoiled. So I want my hand raised more than anything. You know, I want to know that all my hard work, my sacrifice, my dedication, the time that I put in, everything that I'm struggling and I'm suffering for, pays off. You know, so I want my hand raised. I want to know that this guy will never forget me again, because, you know, I put it on him. So I'm looking to do the same thing again to Georgi Karakhanyan next Friday night.
I know that you want to prove yourself as the best of the world, and there's an opportunity for that coming up. It sounds like there was going to be a tournament. So before we get into the fight that's right in front of you, actually, how much fun does a tournament sound like, though?
One fight at a time, one opponent at a time. So I never will overlook someone, look past someone, or think less of someone. learned from people is that you can also not respect them so much. You know, these are other men, just human beings, just like me. You know, that, just like the predator, man, if it bleeds, we can kill it. So I can't fear or can't doubt or hesitate myself against someone who bleeds like I do, you know. So I got to go out there and just impose my will and eliminate all these guys. And it does excite me because I do happen to know that a lot of people see the featherweight division as the best division in all of Bellator. So that right there, that includes me. So that gives me a lot of extra motivation, and that gives me a good satisfaction, you know, knowing that, like, oh, wow, you know, if they want to add another 8 guys, they're talking about a 16-man tournament, you know, so there's going to be more fights. And I mean, the bigger pot, too, you know what I mean? There's more on the line, there's more at risk, so I'm excited for a Grand Prix, and you know, it's going to be amazing.
Now, definitely ahead of us comes next Friday, Bellator 218, main event against Georgi Karakhanyan. How surprising and how much of a change to your training was it, the change of opponent?
Not that much, man. You know, I'm used to everything. You know, it's right here in Rupertsport, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, it's like Thailand, you know. I coached Duke Rufus, he pushes us like ties, and doesn't matter who it is, when it is, where it is, we can adapt and, you know, fight everywhere, and that's our style. You know, we don't just have striking, we don't just have wrestling, jiu-jitsu, etc. We fight everywhere, and that's our job, you know what I mean, to be able to fight anywhere at any time and adapt to anything, you know, to what could potentially happen in the ring. So we are always pushing ourselves as well, too, and when they told me that Grimshaw had pulled out, you know, the only thing that comes to mind sometimes is, you know, you only get worried because you don't know if they're going to put you on another card or people turn down the fight or find you a replacement, etc. You know, but thankfully, that, you know, they did he wasn't in the works and he did accept. So, you know, that means that he was ready to fight or getting ready to fight, you know, pretty soon. And I'm excited, you know what I mean? Like, not just because of history, but because he's a top, tough fighter and he's one of the best in the world. So I know he's a killer. I know what he brings, and I know who he is. You know who I am, etc. And we got a lot more to get, and I can't wait to throw down.
Besides the short notice element of it, do you feel that you can key on kind of some of the similar things from the first fight?
Slightly, you know. But I've seen his, you know, last fight as well after me, and you know I've grown. Since then, a lot too. And I'm still young, man. You know, I'm not old. I'm only 28, you know, so I feel like physically, I'm in a much better place as well, too. Every place, honestly, you know, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, along with physically. You know, I'm learning about myself. You know, I'm still learning a lot about myself. And what I can't do, as I aforementioned, is giving opponents too much respect and holding back. Or, you know, thinking I'm surprised, you know, speaking on Pitbull, it's like, when I dropped him in the first round, it was almost like, oh my God, I almost couldn't believe I dropped him in the first round when I shouldn't be, you know, when I know I landed that good shot, and I should have just carried on with it, and, you know, we'd be talking about a first round knockout, me as a world champion right here, too, you know, so I know what I'm capable of, and I need to fight to my best of my abilities, you know, and, I feel like I still have yet to do that or showcase that to the world. You know, I've done good, man, but good isn't good enough. Got to show great, you know what I mean? I'm out there to achieve greatness, man. That's all I want, and that's all I'm hunting for, is to go out there and when I rewatch myself fight, I never want to think, oh, I could have done this, should have done that, would have done this, whatever. You know, when I rewatch myself fight, I want to be like, yep, I executed exactly what I wanted to do, whether it was done in training or whether it was just an instinct, me being an instinctual fighter, my fight IQ, knowing that, yep, that was a touchdown that I wanted, or up, yep, that was a submission that I wanted, whatever, you know, whatever it may be. So, you know, I'm always looking to improve and better myself, and each and every time that I'm in there, you know, I want to go out there and showcase a better performance. So that's what I can take from my last fight as well, too. And now it taught me a lesson. Now, you know, I get to go and take it in 2019 and for the years to come. come that better than I ever was, but nowhere near as good as I'm going to get. But I'm a lot more dangerous than I was last year and the year before that and the year before that.
When you envision yourself as that optimal version as a fighter, what do you have in mind for who you'll, for what kind of martial artist you'll be at that point?
I guess I'd have to say almost like St. Pierre, man. You know, some of my biggest motivations too, you know, just speaking of title fights and everything is, you know, and I trained with one of them, this Tyron Woodley. You know, people forget that he lost his first title shot. St. Pierre lost his first title shot. BJ Penn lost his first title shot. Robbie Lawler lost, you know, so I, it's never the end of the world, you know. These guys got, you know, 20, 30 plus fights, you know. So I, as my coach as well too, still sees me very young in my career. You know, I still 17 wins, and you know, going 40 deep. So you know, only still 20 professional, still one professional fights, and you know, I'm still growing, learning, evolving, and you know, it does suck, not the results I wanted, but we can only go up from here. My stock only went up, and now I can only go higher. So I see myself as still with another dangerous opponent. Doesn't matter that we fought each other previously, you know, because we're both at different stages and points in our lives right now. I know for sure, you know, and as well too. And we're gonna lock horns, and you know, for the rich gold spoils, you know, I'm just gonna go out there and impose my will and dominate and destroy. Another one will be eliminated, and I will come out with my hand raised.
So that was a total no on if you checked out the first fight, if you had rewatched it before.
Yeah, not recently, but, you know, I have before. And honestly, you know what, it plays out in my mind. I remember that night like it was yesterday, you know. So, I'm not going to say I know what to do, what not to do, whatever, you know, because this is a totally different fight. You know,
right.
It looks like we're totally different fighters. It really is. You know, I'm a totally different fighter since then, too. So, this is a completely different fight. And, you know, this is what excites me. It almost feels like my first fight all over again, to be honest with you. You know, on the road, and like I said, on the hunt for greatness. So, I'm always looking to do better than the last time out. And seeing as having that feeling, it almost feels like it's my first time again to fight. You know, that just leaves me with that same feeling of when the first time was, when I was going out there to fight. There's no hesitation, there's no fear, there's no doubt. I'm not thinking about anything but winning, you know. I'm not thinking about anything but going out there and pulling out something spectacular. You know, an amazing fly knee, an amazing spin attack, an amazing submission, anything to get my hand raised.
Emmanuel, again, always truly awesome getting to talk to you, sir.
Thank you. I appreciate it very much.
Anybody that you needed to thank or shout out to?
It's just my village here. You know, like I mentioned, Rufus Sports, kind of just like Thailand, man. You know, Coach Pete Rufus got everything underneath one roof right here. It takes a village to raise a fighter. So here, you know, we have our little village. Got a combat corner for all my training gear, grip mouth guard, diamond MMA cups, freshman pokey, Iowa bison, Wisconsin Athletic Club, CryoFit Milwaukee. Got my cryotherapy, got my, you know, massage therapy, got chiropractic, got everything that I need all under one roof, you know. And all the fighters pretty much see the same people to get taken care of bumps and bruises or whatever that, you know, we suffer or need in training. And we look out for one another, too. You know, I'm looking out for my teammates look out for me, and, you know, we're all on the hunt for greatness together, you know. We want to be not just number one as individuals, as fighters in our division and our weight class, in our promotions, whatever, et cetera, but as a team in a whole, as a team in the world, you know. So we're a renowned gym, and not only did it take time for me to grow and to get there, to get to where I'm at now, but I want the same for my younger guys coming up right now, too, and for years and years to come, and even myself, too, you know, and continue to keep growing and to get out there and cement my status as, you know, being a legend. You know, it's a legacy that we're carrying on here, and it'll never die.
Emmanuel Sanchez, thank you for the time, sir.
Thank you, my friend. Appreciate it very much.
My pleasure.